Professor Nambiar,
Yes, sir.
please. And Dr. Tribhuvan, it's wonderful we are having a second presentation on cannabis in such a short time.
Yes.
And it gave me some time to think about your topic, which is really fascinating. But before I come to that, I want to make an announcement that I'm very happy to report that we are most likely going to have our Radhakrishnan Memorial Lecture. Rather, I should say Tagore Memorial, because that's happening first, but hopefully both. But the 7th Rabindranath Tagore Memorial Lecture, we have invited Sri Ram Madhav to give it on the 4th of December at 4 p.m. And the topic is the ethical basis of nationalism. And the governor of HP, Honorable Sri Dattatreya Ji, Bandaru Dattatreya Ji, has also agreed to preside over the meeting. So we are trying our best to carry on during the COVID times. So those of you who are here on the 4th have an advance notice. And again, we will be इसमें से वो बैंडेड जैसे लगते हैं कवर करके जो डकैत होते हैं ना वहां के चंबल के विद द टोपी इज इवन मोर डेंजरस नो दिस लुक्स लाइक द देवानंद यू नो दोस ओल्ड फिल्म नोआर
चंबल चंबल डॉक्टर पूज यूज्ड टू यूज गमछा
Gamcha, not good. Yeah, but that can work just as well for COVID, I suppose. Asha, please mute the mic. We'll get this started quickly. And then again, I have to go upstairs and I'll join from upstairs. But I wanted to mention two or three things, you know. The first thing is when we talk about decolonizing cannabis, we should ask how it got colonized in the first place, okay? And there's not much, I was reading about this, there's not that much on cannabis, on the colonization of cannabis, but there's much more on opium, obviously. And the regulations on opium in British India started as early as 1813 and went on, you know, till the early 20th century, till 1911, if I'm not mistaken. And the basic thrust of the British was to ensure that the profitability of opium does not decline, because they were making a lot of money sending opium to China. And the regulations show that the position of the consumption on the British position on the consumption of opium in India was that it was not, you know, what should I say, a social and cultural problem. It was used in moderation. But because it was such an important commodity, cash crop of the empire, they very tightly regulated its cultivation, its shipment and transmission through the empire and beyond. And obviously, the British Empire, as we all know, was a very heterogeneous amalgamation of many hundreds of native states, more than 565. Of which 555 plus came to India, and the few others were in Pakistan. And what was territory controlled directly by the British? And the British controlled about 1 million square miles of territory with about 3/4 of the population. And the Indian states had about 3/4 of this, almost 645 to 700 million square miles. But the population was 1/4. So the native states had a different set of regulations controlled the, you know, cultivation of opium, cannabis, and others slightly differently from the British. And they were interconnected rules when the substance was transported. But gradually the regulations increased so that if you had more than one tola of opium in your possession, you could be prosecuted. And then they also had, just as they had later on for prohibition, you could register yourself as an addict or a user, as a opium smoker. And on the basis of that registration, you could get permission to buy the substance, okay? Now, so in other words, when we have to understand how cannabis was colonized? And the simple answer is it was not that heavily colonized. And even when we have passed our Narcotics, Drugs and Psychotropic Substances Act in 1985, NDPS, which was already amended three times, this act was passed, as far as I've understood, to keep us in conformity with the UN rules and regulations on precisely these narcotic and psychotropic substances. So the UN started a single convention on narcotic drugs in 1971, and they kept regulating till in 1988, they had a comprehensive convention against illicit traffic in narcotic drugs and psychotropic substances. And Indian legislation was an attempt to dovetail, you know, our policies with the international regulations, okay? So in other words, what I'm trying to say is before we decolonize cannabis, we have to find out how we colonized it. And much of the so-called colonization of cannabis was a post-independent phenomenon. And as I mentioned in my last introduction, colonization, decolonization are very closely linked. So that when we seem to decolonize, we are doing it because we are copying the impulses that are coming to us from outside. For example, there's a huge movement to decriminalize cannabis, you know, because of its proven effects in pain regulation and prophylactics in cancer treatment. So in some ways, we are playing catch up. So our decolonization is also a form of colonization. Though our masters are different, you know, so to speak. So this is a paradox you have to deal with. But the thing that I wanted to mention, jaisa ki hum sab log jante hain, aaj hamare yahan do hum keh sakte hain virodhatmak prakriyaen chal rahi hain samaj mein. On the one hand, you have this Bollywood scandal over drugs, where people are being targeted, you know, hum har roz kuch na kuch padh rahe hain, hai na? And on the other hand, there's actually a bill moved, a private member's bill in parliament, moved by a man called Dr. Dharmendra Gandhi from Punjab, to decriminalize cannabis and opium, by the way, not just cannabis. That's why I linked the two. So wo bill kafi aage badh chuka hai, 2016 ka bill hai, abhi act nahi hua hai, but there have been a number of representations. There's an Odisha MP also who's moving it, and they have met the Prime Minister also. So these two paradoxically oppositional trends are evident in society. On the one hand, you're targeting people, you know, for not just hard drugs and, you know, cocaine, heroin, whatever, but also for weed, what is called weed. On the other hand, you're trying to decriminalize because you're trying to separate recreational from medicinal use, you know. So ye bhi ho raha hai. And the last thing I wanted to say before I come to the abstract of Dr. Prabhuvan is that one of the difficulties, I'm sure Dr. Nambiar as a policeman will also attest to it, is that these drugs, what are called drugs, you know, it's a very large umbrella. And it includes, you know, a spectrum of things. It includes chemicals. It includes meth, amphetamines, all kinds of things. And they're all clubbed under the same umbrella, okay? And this comes to the heart of this, you know, the project, which I'll come to in a moment. But kehne ka matlab ye hai ki when we think about drug trafficking, then you find connections between the much more harmful substances and the somewhat more recreational substances. So substance abuse gets complicated because the cartels or the gangs or the networks or the pushers are pushing very harmful substances. I mean, the same people are also pushing cannabis, is my point. And so there's a slippery slope, you know. We have to tread carefully on this slippery slope of illegality, you know. And this is exactly, if you've been following the Sushant Singh Rajput suicide / whatever investigations and all the people implicated, you'll see some your neighborhood friendly pushers seem to be perfectly respectable people living in Bandra and Santa Cruz and Versova, and who knows if they have links with many more dangerous thugs and criminals on different sides of the border, abroad, cartels. And so the legal and criminal and underworld aspects get far more complicated than just the academic discussion that we are having. Okay, and now I come to the heart of the project, which I like. This is what I wanted to come to. You know, there is a way to avoid all these complications by simply arguing that cannabis is a indeterminate signifier. In other words, that the difficulty in having this discussion is the contradictory and fluctuating significations of the term cannabis. This can be the heart of the project, which can save you from, you know, entanglement and all these other complicated issues. And I think you go there by saying that the most significant aspect of cannabis's engagement with post-Enlightenment Western institutions has been cannabis's peculiar ability to resist classification on physical, conceptual, and moral categories. I think this is the heart of the topic, you know, a certain kind of indeterminacy as to the very meaning of or the implications or significations of cannabis, which then results in these surrounding complications. And I think some of this came up when Professor Raju made a very strong moral argument in favor of cannabis last time. But I think this resistance to classification is what makes cannabis interesting, and which also problematizes the very idea of decolonizing cannabis. Because if it resists classification, then to call it colonized is as problematic as to say or advocate its decolonization. It's precisely, and you will see in United States, there's several states in which it's perfectly legal. You can grow it, you can buy it, smoke it. In some states, it's partly legal. You can acquire it if you have a prescription. So even within the 50 states of the US, you know, the meaning varies. And in India, as usual, we have a beautiful arrangement. It's illegal, but not enforced. This is how we are here in India. A lot of things, you know, we just look the other way. We just look the other way, you know. So, but we will look your way, sir. I invite you to please make your presentation. I'll join from upstairs. Thank you all so much. Thank you.
Good afternoon to one and all. It's after a long time that I am dealing with the drugs. Maybe, yes, 10 years back.
As long as you don't deal in drugs.
Yeah.
Okay. Please speak in the mic.
Yeah.
I said, yes. Please speak in the mic. You're not speaking in the mic.
Okay. The term cannabis. It is actually a controversial figure or controversial substance. As Dr. has already said, I will not go into detail or I will not repeat it. But the thing is that there are lot many reports, articles, which says that cannabis is good for human health. At the same time, there are also reports, numerous reports, which says that it is harmful to the body. So that is why I use the term controversy. Now, if we think about India, it is banned. As such, it is banned. Now, why it is banned? The report says that the amount of revenue earned by the government while letting the liquor and tobacco companies run their business in our country. This cartel exercises its influence to not let a safer and cheaper competition enter the market, for they are bound to lose. So there are so many reasons. Along with this, this is also one of the important reasons. Now, when we talk of people, those who are taking marijuana, how many of them know that whether they are taking the original thing or something duplicate? It says that more than 50% of the marijuana consumed in India is actually not marijuana. Most of the people addicted to marijuana are actually addicted to the chemical present in the spiked marijuana they get, and not THC, the main active ingredient in marijuana. The sad part about this is that mostly half of these consumers are not aware of this fact and blindly indulge in it by virtue of ritualism or tradition. So there are so many reasons. So it is in all these contexts, the study of Dr. Prasenjit assumes high significance. Why it is high significance? Actually, I was going through his proposal, and he says, there is an urgent need to rethink about cannabis if we were to reclaim its humility, arrest the menace its present avatar has caused, and mitigate the potential risk associated with it, while utilize it towards building a prosperous, just society. Decolonizing cannabis, particularly, and working towards decolonizing other forms of material culture, is a project whose time has long been overdue, and this work looks to contribute to that project. The aim here is to understand how power relations inscribe themselves within material bodies and how these materials act as mediums for power and hegemony to manifest its across time zones and geographical location. This shows one of the importance of this study. Now, having said this, certainly I will have to introduce today's presenter. Dr. Prasenjit Tripura is a social anthropologist. He completed his PhD from the Department of Sociology, Delhi School of Economics, Delhi University in 2017. He is an assistant professor of sociology at IIT Jodhpur. Dr. Prasenjit's research interests lie at the intersections of ontology and social anthropology, youth studies, material cultures studies, STS, and study of Himalayan studies. He has a few international publications to his credit, and currently also working on a monograph based on his PhD research. So with this introduction, I invite Dr. Prasenjit to make his presentation. Now, all is yours.
Okay, I hope. Thank you so much, Professor Nambiar, and thank you so much, Professor Brandapik. In fact, before I start, this time I spent at IIS, I was thinking that it's so much like winter. I mean, it's so productive in a sense. In winter, when it snows, you can see those mountains which are far away. They suddenly become visible. And my time at IIS, especially my presentation and my discussions with all the fellows and with Professor Prasenjit, they have made certain things visible to me, which were not visible till now. You know, it has snowed on those mountains, those conceptual mountains, so as to say. And yes, I'm thankful. So that is what has, so thank you for that. And with that, I'll just start my presentation. I'll just start reading. So quote unquote, I'll start with the quotation. So when you have cannabis, you may feel really happy or extremely sad and paranoid. When you have cannabis, your appetite may increase at first, but then it may decrease and completely vanish, but no one knows for sure. In fact, in Ayurveda, it's called the herb which enables the poor to withstand famines while it creates appetite for the rich. Mm-hmm. When you have cannabis, you may feel sexually excited, or you may become completely ascetic and numb to those feelings as you smoke more, but no one knows for sure. Very few people know how cannabis affects them. This is an interpretation quoted from the work of an ethnobotanist, Dr. V.M. Nadkarni, from his 1979 book on medicinal plants in Himachal and a few other parts of North India. So when I did my introductory presentation at the IIS, there were certain biases in my mind, which were challenged by the discussion we had after the presentation. One significant bias that I especially put my time in working on towards was the sort of uniformity and comfort in dealing with the herb. I mean, I thought that there was uniformity and comfort in dealing with this herb, across India before colonization. That a country where cannabis has been documented to be part of indigenous landscapes and culture, we were always comfortable while engaging with it. My initial sense was that the apprehensions, moral ambivalence, and even demonization of cannabis were only introduced into the subcontinent after colonization and appropriation of cannabis by Western powers, especially the US, and after independence. And to some degrees, illegalization did attach certain meanings to cannabis and acts of its consumption that were not earlier a part of the bouquet of meanings associated with it. But further research into local practices and narratives in different parts of the countries shows that it was not as well accepted in all regions and communities as one may think. And cannabis and its use was strictly reprimanded by some communities. Now, there's no doubt that cannabis consumption was an integral part of social life in many parts of India. There are many documents and narratives to prove that, but I will cite two. One is the frequent mention of cannabis in ancient texts, including Ayurveda, shows that cannabis has been used for both enjoyment and medicine for a long time across the country. Kant and Sharma's work shows that Ayurveda was a medical text based on everyday practices. It was more a log of everyday practices in India, and it was not some, you know, it was not written by so-called medical experts. It was a log of everyday practices. And that's why, you know, Ayurveda and also other ancient texts show the extent of cannabis in the country as a medicine. And two, there were at least three large-scale surveys carried out by the British, which reflect regular use of the herb as an intoxicant and medicine across the country. The most notable among them being the Indian Hemp Commission survey released in 1894. Now, many people who are pro-legalization, they generally quote this survey and when they ask for legalization of cannabis, and this is why. Because this survey found that cannabis use was common in all parts of the country. The main aim of conducting the survey was to understand cannabis use in the country and its effect on the human mind and body, and if necessary, ban its use completely. You know, because since it was comparatively a new herb even for many British officers. Now, after a voluminous report cut across the regions of the country, the survey concludes, and I quote from the survey, "It has been clearly established that the occasional use of hemp in moderate doses may be beneficial, and that in respect to the alleged mental effects of the drug, the commission has come to the conclusion that the moderate use of hemp drugs produces no injuries or effects on the mind and does not recommend any restrictions on a habit that was so well entrenched in the Indian social life. However, the report does find cannabis harmful in large quantities and when used for a long time." Now, ironically, two Indian doctors who worked on the report, Dr. Nihal Chand and Dr. Raja Chaudhary, were of a different opinion. They wanted cannabis to be prohibited across the country, a conclusion different than the commission report. Their main point of contention was that the report had ignored some important empirical data from mental asylums, which did point to a close relationship between insanity and cannabis consumption, even in less quantities. The doctors felt that the commission had rushed to its conclusion and willfully ignored important data to avoid any repercussions from banning cannabis from its most profitable and cannabis-consuming colony. Moreover, the fact that the British instead decided to tax cannabis on seeing its large-scale use in the country also puts the conclusion of the report in the grey. In fact, the first instance of relation of criminality with cannabis use was because of taxation, similar to opium, because of taxation issues that the British encountered in India. Many ganja and charas producers refused to pay tax to the Britishers and used different ways to evade this tax. Evasion happened at such a large scale that the British later thought of completely banning cannabis because of criminals involved with it. So actually the first instance of criminalization was purely for economic reasons in India. And this Dr. James Mills has done a very good study on this particular report. This is from his report. Also, a study of a few reports from across the country suggests that cannabis use was in some regions restricted to particular castes. For example, in most districts of Garhwal and Kumaon, cannabis consumption was regulated by caste position. A British officer notes in 1840, "Brahmins and Rajput look at cannabis consumption unfavorably and those amongst them who smoked or consumed it were chastised. The practice was more common among the so-called lower class. In Delhi and central India, however, it was used almost across class lines. Okay. For example, J. Penny, a civil surgeon in British India, writes, and I quote, "In Delhi, it was observed that both the rich and the poor among Hindus indulged in this narcotics, whereas only the lower class of Mohammedan partake in it. The habitual indulgers are to be seen in the saises, the dhobis, the fakirs, the laborers, the kahars, and the halal cows. They may be found in groups of 20 or 30 from 3 to 5 in the afternoon, either in Panchkuah or on Eidghar or on the banks of Jamuna. Brahmins, Mahajans, and Vanyas generally smoke charas at their own houses every day in the afternoon." In the northwest provinces of Punjab and Sindh, cannabis was largely demonized across caste and community lines. There was a saying, if one smokes charas, one's learning is diminished, the seed is burned up within, coughing goes on till one's belly bursts, and one's face grows red like that of a monkey. There was a typical poetry from Sindh, which also rhymes, but it also rhymes in English somehow. But it's not charas, but a curse. It's not charas, but a curse. It burns the chest and heart to its worst. It brings on dimness of the eyes. To phlegm and cough, it must give rise. To blind the eyes, it never fails, or cripple limbs that once were hale. In what but death ends its sad tale. Now, one may add here that conflicting discourses and practices related to cannabis and its diversity of use have some similarity with other intoxications, like opium and alcohol. However, there was a recognition in regions like Himachal Pradesh, where both the substances grew or were produced, that cannabis has much less effect on physical health than opium or alcohol, and that its mind altering qualities but also lesser than the former two intoxicants. Moreover, medicinal uses of cannabis were more well-known than any other intoxicant. A study of medicinal texts, ethnobotanical research, and some practices prevalent even now shows that cannabis was most frequently used as an aphrodisiac in India since ancient times. A combination of dried cannabis leaves, clarified butter or ghee, and pepper was used as a common remedy for diarrhea. There are so many references that come here, but I'm not, taking the names for the sake of continuity. Now, smoking of cannabis was considered good for the digestive system. A combination of cannabis leaves, turmeric, and warm oil was used as external application of piles. Cannabis was used to, and still is used to, increase appetite in sick people whose appetite was destroyed. Ayurveda lists cannabis as a medicine for treating cholera and yellow fever, and preparation made from it as antiphlegmatic, and it recommends the use of cannabis for cold and cough, especially for those instances of cold that cause bouts of extra phlegm. Cannabis is also recorded as an anti-diabetic and might have been used for the same in earlier times. Okay. And these uses are only the ones listed from Indian texts and practices. Recent medical research in the West has enabled use of cannabis for many more diseases as a pain reliever and as a substance that can be used to relieve symptoms of some serious ailments like HIV, cancer, etc. I will not be wrong in saying that in the history of substances and materials, very few substances have had as many uses and yet have been regularly chastised for their negative effects as cannabis. Another aspect of cannabis symbolism and use in India was its religious significance. Ancient Indian texts explicitly denoted cannabis plants and few derivatives obtained from it as sacred. The Atharva Veda anoints cannabis as one of the five Amritas. And Amrita has a particularly sacred character in Indian mythology. It is said that a guardian angel resides within the leaves of the cannabis plants. Cannabis seeds were thrown into the fire during special holy ceremonies called yagnas, during yagnas, to be held to appease certain gods. During childbirth, it has been a tradition to burn cannabis seeds in delivery rooms to keep unholy spirits away, especially near the hills. There was a period when profane or everyday use of cannabis was restricted by Hindu religion, since cannabis had gained a distinctly sacred character. However, the fact that cannabis was also used medically might have mitigated this restriction. Almost every household in Himalayas grew at least a couple of plants of cannabis to offer it to a passing ascetic or a holy man, since it was considered to be virtue on the part of the householders. Cannabis also is also known as Vijaya in Sanskrit. A few other plants are also known, but Vijaya, cannabis is mainly known as Vijaya, which literally means victory. This name has its roots in mythical story of Manthar. Also, cannabis was sometimes consumed following this particular myth by soldiers going to war as a symbol of good luck. Now, cannabis shares a special relationship with Shiva in its most popular form. The myth says that when Shiva went to meditate in the Himalayas for more than 100 years, he noticed the cannabis plant. On consuming it, he was highly impressed by its ability to satiate his soul and make him peaceful, and also helped him in his penance. Again, this religious significance was not uniform throughout the country, even in Hinduism. For example, an incident from Bengal, where cannabis was considered profane and it had no religious significance whatsoever, may throw some light on how religious significance of cannabis may have been propagated through some means. Now, a movement called Trinath worship was started in 1867 by a former policeman, Anand Chandra Kali. The focus of the worship was Hindu holy trinity of Brahma, Vishnu and Shiva. The main aim of the movement was to unite the community, the Hindu community he was living with, which had recently seen some caste violence. An avid ganja smoker himself, he introduced ganja as prasad as a part of the worship. Ganja smoking in Bengal that time was mainly a practice among the lower castes, the so-called lower castes. Anand Chandra included the practice especially to include the lower caste and make them feel accepted into the upper caste community. Soon the practice would spread across caste boundaries. The inspector of excise at that time, Mr. Abhilash Chandra Mukherjee, explained that the worship had quickly spread as it appealed to many ganja smokers of the region and it legitimized their habit. In the Himalayas during my fieldwork, there are at least two popular narratives that question the religious glorification of cannabis. One narrative questioned the intention of ascetics who smoke cannabis. Quite a few elders felt that the constant invocation of Lord Shiva while smoking cannabis was an attempt to conceal their hedonistic tendencies, especially by the sadhus, and to some extent, their addiction to cannabis. Secondly, there were a few instances when the local deities or the devtas of the villages who generally give orders to ghurs or a particular person or oracles, local oracles in Himalayan villages are called ghurs, to whom the devtas speak, would ban consumption of cannabis within their village boundaries for some time. Now, when such orders were passed, there were regular debates between villagers whether it was prudent to consume cannabis because the local devtas essentially banned it in the boundaries. One could sense that quite a few villagers did not particularly like the religious endorsement of a rather profane activity, which sometimes also needed to be curtailed. So there is this, you know, there is always this opposition to this particular feeling that that cannabis has religious, you know, that its consumption is sort of religiously, what can I say, prescribed or sanctioned. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, sanctioned. Okay. All right. So even before modern institutions like the states and its legal apparatus tried to regulate cannabis with questionable prohibition laws, contradiction in cannabis use and its effects were apparent. And that was, now, modernity, which prides itself on knowledge and use of this knowledge, I'm talking about Western European modernity, and use of this knowledge to build institutions and laws that influence social practice, finds itself at loss when it encounters substances like cannabis. Cannabis resists classification, and for a system which prides itself on creation of knowledge, its classification and further purification, substances like cannabis pose a challenge to its very survival. A closer look at the way cannabis was first banned in Europe and North America shows the role of brute force, racist bias, myth, ignorance, and very little research behind the move. That a civilization that has tried to project its superiority based on rationalism and objectivity clearly did not use both these tropes when regulating a herb questions its claim to superiority. The periodic revision of cannabis laws, and in some cases, complete reversal of policies,
are closest one can get to admission of mistake on behalf of these countries. However, flexibility in policy is an essential criteria for effective regulation of cannabis. And in this sense, countries like the USA have rightly acknowledged the policy of having a uniform, long-standing cannabis policy. Cannabis, in this sense, is a perfect representative of the unpredictability of nature and the mistaken notion of modern institutions that they can ruin nature or its parts. The unknowability of cannabis again comes forth when a few countries who legalize cannabis are thinking about revoking complete legalization and bringing back some restrictions in its use. Amsterdam is thinking of, you know, revoking some of its some of the freedom that it has given for cannabis use. Yeah. Some theories related to cannabis are still ambiguous at its best. An example can be of the gateway theory. Now, the gateway theory is basically it's a theory in how individuals or groups get addicted to this entire process of taking drugs to feel good. Okay. Now, the thing is, earlier cannabis was demonized, saying that it's a gateway drug. A gateway drug is essentially once you start using that drug, right? The thing is, you get used to getting high. Right. And now once you start using cannabis and you get that high and then you stop getting high from cannabis, what happens is that you graduate to some other drug. You graduate to cocaine or you graduate to heroin. And these drugs can be more, even opium is more harmful than cannabis. Now, this gateway theory by many scientific papers, they have renounced this gateway theory. This is because this graduation, empirical research shows that the graduation from cannabis to opium, to heroin, that does not take place, right? And people who do heroin are not actually always addicted to cannabis. This is what empirical research shows. Now, the problem is that socially, this seems to be a little problematic, because my research, my field work, and even otherwise shows that although cannabis does not, you know, may not psychologically want you to get you to upper level, but it does introduce you to those social groups which indulge in this kind of behavior. Right? So the gateway theory, maybe medically it may not be sound, but the thing is, socially and socioculturally, because it introduces you to groups and it introduces to that particular behavior where you can actually alter your mood when you have something, right? That is, and that sort of gives some credence to the gateway theory. And just one interesting thing, what happens when one smokes cannabis is that the THC, so we already have something called as endocannabinoids in our body, in our brain. So the THC that cannabis has, it reacts with endocannabinoids in the brain and in the stomach and in other parts of the body. And then it sort of, it releases a certain hormone, a certain secretion, which is responsible for a particular form of ecstasy in the brain, and this is sort of a reward center in the brain, and this just generally happens when, for example, when someone wins in a race, or when you earn money, or when you win lottery, right? So that particular secretion is secreted, sort of, that hormone is secreted in the brain, and that hormone is called anandamide. You know, it's from the Hindi word ananda, and this was actually discovered from some German scientists in their labs, and they named it anandamide because of its relationship with cannabis. So anyway, yeah. So, okay. So some authors like Subrisky and others contend that cannabis laws are fleeting and confusing because enough research still has not happened on cannabis. It's been comparatively new to the West. Such contentions can, however, be contested on the basis that such contradictions and doubts never arose in case of opium, cocaine, and other intoxicants, which are also comparatively new to the West. In such a scenario, the best policy initiative that seems to work would be two-pronged: granularity in terms of space, that is, no uniform law across the country, and flexibility in terms of time, that is, ability to change. Additionally, the policy should also take into account what Ron Sanchio calls vegetal ontologies. Vegetal ontological approach, to some extent, means that we take into account plant agency while we define laws for its regulation. Here we ask questions like, should regulation of a living thing be similar to regulation of a non-living thing? A plant is, after all, a force of nature. Even if you ban its consumption, how will you stop its growth without harming its ecological balance? It is even more difficult for plants like cannabis, where you don't need special equipment to produce intoxicating substance. Now, my chapter 3 looks at this aspect in detail. We'll look at this aspect in detail. Now, our next agenda in this presentation will be to understand how has social theory studied cannabis and its use. Now, social theory has studied cannabis through the lens of social deviance. Largely, I mean, these are the four categories: social deviance, the Foucauldian knowledge power sort of framework, sociocultural practices, and policy analysis. There has been a gamut of empirical studies analyzing effects of cannabis on human bond and model, but these are mostly, these are mostly published in scientific journal. These are medical scientific sort of studies. Now, a great part of social theory on cannabis assumes the moral legal framework around cannabis as a given, and either uses it uncritically to analyze cannabis use in society. For example, theories on deviance, who actually already assume that smoking cannabis is a deviance, or uses that framework to delineate the power relations, cultural biases, and historical inequalities that have led to an appropriation of cannabis by political elites and its alienation from its diverse socio-cultural context. While both kinds of work have immensely contributed in understanding cannabis use in the society, they are weighed down by subtle, sometimes unintentional, yet pervasive ideological allegiance. Work on cannabis cultures in different parts of the world, now, I mean, some are pro-cannabis, some are anti-cannabis, and it shows through their too much of the work that they do. Anyways, now the next kind of work. So work on cannabis cultures in different parts of the world is especially helpful in understanding how communities have assimilated cannabis within their cultural framework and benefited from its use while at the same time mitigated its harm to some extent. So there are many studies which show how sociocultural use in India has been traditionally used, how it has been traditionally used in Jamaica, for example. Traditionally, as in Jamaica, it came only in the 19th century, but since then they have been using. Or cannabis was also used in other, in Middle East, for example, in Central Asia, for example. So those studies are there. However, much of this kind of work suffers from an uncritical stance to cannabis's potential to cause harm or just address it in a cursory manner. Now, there is a problem. There is a problem with cannabis. You know, youth do get addicted, not to cannabis, but to other substances. And these are generally the social gateway theory that we're talking about. Now, many of the studies that look at the cultural practices of cannabis generally do not touch upon this particular aspect of cannabis. Some of them do, but there is a sense that, you know, somehow the community has mitigated the risk associated with cannabis. Okay. Yeah. Now, one more problem with this is that much of this social scientific inquiry into cannabis can be classified into particular frameworks, like I have said, but they do not talk to each other, right? Now, literature on policy work, which I earlier mentioned on cannabis, perhaps comes closest to appreciating diversity in cannabis literature and providing a platform where works on medical science, empirical research, and cultural use can converse with each other. However, policy studies suffer from either lack of historical insight or rigidity of presentation owing to pressures of trying to look objective and advise recommendations. So there's always this pressure, what to do. Like, you know, if I want to work on policy, I'll always have a time-bound pressure, right? So you sort of conduct that sort of research which would support your policy. So you know, that has been a problem to some extent. Now, the works that I have discussed above may look at cannabis through different lenses, but they have one feature that binds all of them together, and that is anthropocentrism. In most works on cannabis, the plant itself is subsumed under layers of political theory, philosophy, or power relations, which are a result of particular human-centric methodologies that follow theoretical frameworks defined since centuries. Now, the recent ontological turn in social anthropology, which borrows from many influences, including object studies in sociology, critiques such anthropocentrism. Social scientists from the global South, especially in Latin America and South Asia, like Appa Durai and others, were already talking about new methodologies that corrected Eurocentrism in social anthropology. Academic practices like using Western cultural constructs to interpret indigenous cultures and social practice in South Asia and Latin America were typically criticized. While the ontological turn has many faces to it, I will only discuss those aspects which are important to my work. Now, the neglect of non-humans in social sciences is an important critique that ontological turn borrows from material theories. Scholars like Viviero de Castro and Philip Descola, they're Latin American scholars, have argued that the epistemological stance of separating nature from culture and a marked bias towards studying culture in social sciences has caused an oversight of ecological colonization and destruction in global south by both disciplines and academicians. When Appadurai urges us to follow objects in his influential work, he's actually delineating a methodology that frees us from traditional frameworks. His work gives us the freedom to write a biography of objects and thus come up with stories and facets to truth which an anthropocentric gaze has always denied us. Now, giving up anthropocentrism does not mean that we neglect humans for objects. Rather, it means we give equal importance to humans and non-humans as practitioners of social sciences. Like we as practitioners of social sciences give equal importance to humans and non-humans. Like what Ayan Bogos writes, in short, all things equally exist, yet they do not exist equally. Once we come to this term of what is today in social anthropology is known as flat ontology, we can understand Dilanda's proposition of conceptualizing materials, processes, things, humans, non-humans, and even social structures as forces and visualize a world where these forces are responsible for certain flows. This does not mean that we give up on important concepts like structures and power relations, but we imagine them as fluid forces that play a significant role in shaping our life rather than static frameworks which are unchanging and unchallenged for a long time. Now, this book, now this my project, it tries to give an equal importance to cannabis, to humans, to social structures, to individual and other non-humans, and studied them as fluid entities which change and are changed due to interactions between them. Now, keeping that in mind, I would just like to present my chapterization. So, yeah, this is the only slide that I have actually. Where is it? Is it? Oh, okay. So this is my chapterization. So one is introduction. I think some of it I have presented. Most of it I have presented. Then the first chapter. So I have three chapters. The three chapters are plant, people, policy. These are the larger sort of, you know, sort of thematic areas. Within that, there will be a couple of sections, I guess. But these are the larger thematic areas. Now, plant is basically, which if we have time, I will read out a part of it. It's basically a relational biography of a cannabis plant in the Himalayas. It's a biography of a cannabis plant where I follow a newly born cannabis plant, and you know, I try to see how it grows and what are the kind of things that it comes across, etc. Yeah. The second section is people, right? So people is the stories or life stories of those people during my fieldwork, during my ethnography, whose life has been altered by cannabis, or whose life has been entangled with the life of cannabis in such a way that it has changed both of them, right? So this will include biographies of cultivators who have been arrested, dealers, international tourists who have been or who have not have been arrested, Delhi University student as a drug tourist, historical figures like Harry Aslinger, who was mainly responsible for banning cannabis across the US and later across the world. Since this is an interspecies ethnography, like I always keep talking about non-humans. So I will also talk about a dog. So there's this dog called Rebel who got eaten by a leopard, and this dog was given as a gift as a puppy by an international drug tourist to a local villager, you know, because he used to stay at his place. And the way the dog's life itself was sort of, you know, influenced by the entire cannabis situation, you know, by the small plant, right? It's a very interesting sort of an interspecies, how plants, people, and animals sort of, you know, influence each other's lives. So that is what I'm trying to do here. Then I'll also include a biography of a policeman and a fictional character, Now, there are a few, a couple of fictional characters that I came across. There is one in Hindi literature, but it's small. So I want to, that day, but I'm not able to talk about it now. But, you know, I hope that I can flesh out something from there. Final will be policy. Policy will, of course, talk about the present status. Present status, they, of course, like Professor Parandappa mentioned, it's illegal. But it's not enforced. It's not enforced legality. But the thing is, the way that we are working now, it works as a public secret. And when it's a public secret, where you know many people do it, but it's illegal. What happens is that in a condition of a public secret, it's generally very advantageous for people who wield power, right? So it's generally advantageous for state. It is generally advantageous for media. So that whenever a situation comes, right, when like recently, when you want to either trouble someone or when you want to, you know, when you want to sort of divert public attention from a particular place, you can always take this out and, you know, use this against the people you want to use it against. And at that time, the consumer is always powerless. The condition of public secret sort of, you know, ensures that the powerless always remain powerless, and the state. And nowadays, the media, you know, wields a certain amount of power over those who consume. I'm sorry, but there's also an article of mine which appeared in Wired with respect to this. I will share it later. It's about the Riya Chakraborty case and how, you know, how this has happened, how this particular thing has happened, you know, where where media houses, just to divert our attention from whatever is happening, you know, they yield so much power just because we are living in a state of public secret when it comes to cannabis. So anyway, yeah. And then we go ahead in the policy. Now the policy part will be more of an analytical chapter, because there will also be an empirical analysis of best practices around the world and India. Sikkim has a very good practice and in India, and Sikkim has also seen a great fall in drug consumption. Because basically its policy is decriminalization. Now there's a difference between decriminalization and legalization. Decriminalization is basically where state as a policy does not take any action against those with whom small amounts of cannabis are formed. Like for example, what we see nowadays, when 10 grams, if an actress is possessing 10 grams of cannabis, it becomes national news. So that's, those sort of ironies do not, or paradoxes do not take place when decriminalization happens. So what you're trying to do is, you're saying that, you know, that you are doing something wrong, but it is not punishable by law. But then again, you are not encouraging large scale sort of, dealing for profit. Yeah. And also this public secret, one more thing is that, you know, the channels through which, especially in my field, the problem is that once you sort of relate cannabis to something which is illegal, other illegal things start coming with it. You know, like big drug dealers start coming to small villages, right? And through these channels through which cannabis is sort of supplied, these channels sort of, you know, they make way for other drugs to come in. You know, because this channel, the way they come in through this particular social network, right? Through different, maybe state, through villagers, through natives, through dealers, right? Now this channel is set up already, right, because of cannabis, and now then it becomes easier to push more harmful drugs into this channel, right? So better policy would be to decriminalize cannabis and see to it that this channel is destroyed completely, so that, you know, other more harmful substances do not get into the regions. Yeah. And then finally, this will also contain empirical analysis of scientific papers, and finally a policy document. That is what I hope. So I guess do we have time, or should we? My plan was to just read one chapter, but I guess we can use that time for question answers. Or I mean, it's what should I do? Should I? So I'll just give a glimpse of the chapter as such. Yeah. So my chapter one, which starts with a biography of the cannabis plant. I explain the concept of what non-human biographies are. Like humans, non-humans take birth, live, and die. Following non-humans as they traverse their life worlds through space and time tells us stories of both humans and non-humans, which conventional human ethnographies find difficult to pick up, articulate, or convey. Non-humans, in many cases, lead a humble life, hidden away from public gaze under layers of human relations and social structures. However, this humility in some cases is facile and disorienting because it obscures their impact on our lives. The biographical method not only rescues materials from their obscurity, it also tells us how and why certain materials affect us the way they do. It tells us how politics and culture shape lives of non-humans in our society, and more significantly, vice versa. Object biographies demystify material agency or the ability of materials to influence human life and help us to unearth the modalities through which material agency operates. The biographical method is not new to social sciences. Archaeologists have been doing it for years. And recently, material sociologists have borrowed the idea and done some wonderful work around it. However, biographies of living non-humans cannot be narrated as linear stories. What I will be doing is a relational biography of a cannabis plant. A relational biography is a non-linear narrative of an object's life, which may include intermediate shifts and jumps to different points in the narrative, enabling us to understand how temporal and spatial distributions are implicated in their ongoing life trajectories. Relational biographies also help us to uncover the network of relationships of which objects are a part of and how these networks affect the object's reality. As in humans, non-humans are also a product of that particular time and space, but at the same time are connected to each other across these distances. For example, the life trajectory of a cannabis plant grown commercially in a valley in the Indian Himalayas is markedly different from that of a commercially grown cannabis plant in California. However, the life world of a cannabis plant in California affects the lived reality of the cannabis plant and surroundings in the Indian Himalayas and vice versa. Yeah, so I start with cannabis biography, birth in the Rupi Valley. So most of the names I've taken are aliases, you know, they're pseudonyms for obvious reasons. So the event of the birth of an illegally grown plant, cannabis plant, is the result of a confluence of forces which are ecological, social, and historical. Now the cannabis plant, the birth is in the Rupi Valley. The Rupi Valley is a dense mountainous region with typical geological, environmental, and climatic features of lesser and medium Himalayan ranges, ranging from an altitude of 1500 meters to 4500 meters. Most of the valley lies in a precipitous zone with good monsoon rainfall, which lasts from July to September, but it may rain almost throughout the year. The lower and the mid regions of the valley have a typically thick covering of soil, which when combined with adequate rainfall supports dense vegetation. Some food crops such as maize and rice are grown. However, major crops are fruits such as apples, plums, and apricots. The soil, geological and physical features, and the climatic conditions in the regions are particularly favorable for a particular strain of cannabis plant found growing wild. The geographical features and climatic conditions also make the valley a popular tourist destination. Agriculture, animal husbandry, and forestry have traditionally formed backbone of the economy of the region. These forms of livelihood persist even today, but gradually, a considerable population has shifted to activities that are more market-oriented, which include horticulture and tourism. Rupi Valley emerged as an important destination for drug tourism in the early part of this millennium. Some places in the valley, like the famed abode of the Jamlu Devta, have been popular amongst erstwhile hippie tourists since the 1970s. In the next two decades, that is the 80s and the 90s, with increasing demand from tourists, the European tourists, the old hippie tourists, and illicit domestic and international markets, commercial cultivation of cannabis plants increased manifold in the region, and also witnessed increasing prosperity. Charas tourism in the region continued as a public secret with tacit cooperation between tourists, natives, state representatives, and law enforcers. The process of cannabis for cultivation is a part of this public secret. Now, spaces where cannabis is cultivated in this valley are located in high altitudes bound within the regions of steep mountains and treacherous terrain. Plantations cannot be present in areas accessible to tourists or police, since cultivating cannabis without license is a punishable offense with a nature of punishment ranging from 6 months to 10 years. Cultivation is generally 10 years of rigorous imprisonment as per the NDPS Act. Police personnel destroy cannabis plantations as a part of their annual drive of a local police department to curb the illegal trade. The owner of the piece of land on which it has been cultivated is arrested and tried under the most stringent auspices of the NDPS Act. Cannabis is therefore cultivated in spaces which are perceived, which are known to be difficult to reach even for trained hikers and for trained policemen. And the spaces so chosen are strategically located in forest regions on slopes or on top of high mountains. A typically good piece of land for illicit cultivation will be on the slope of a tall mountain near the mountain top, preferably hidden by a rock formation such that it is not visible from below. The land should be away from common mountain paths, and the way should be on a steep slope winding through inaccessible forests or through slippery rocks or both, making access extremely difficult. From the beginning of April to start of May, cultivators go to the forest land on the mountain slope to sow cannabis seeds. Sowing of seeds and other activities related to charas is generally referred to as going on a mission or upar ki aur jana ya jungle mein jana. Land on which the seeds are sown belongs to the forest department. Forest land is convenient to use for the purpose, since even if the police stumble across these cultivated fields during their periodic raids, the liability of the cultivator is minimal, unless of course if he gets caught, if he is physically present on the plantation. Land for cannabis cultivation is secured physically by a household during winter months for the next sowing season starting in April. Once a family demarcates a piece of land, or once a cultivator demarcates a piece of land, it is out of bounds for others in the community, although work on the land is carried on a communal basis. The entire process of cultivation is sustainable mainly through mutual cooperation between households and individuals. To a large extent, main processes that are involved in cultivation follow a particular cultural practice called as Jwaru. I define what Jwaru is, but I think I should stop here. And then from here, I basically go on to the, since I have already promised that what I'll do, I jumped across narratives. So from local labor, local cultural practice, the birthing of the cannabis plant is also a result of illegalization, which sometimes happened in the US, you know, so how history is also connected into that particular event of birth. So that is how this entire chapter goes. And so from birth, you know, to looking at the historical forces that give rise to birth, the social inequalities that give rise to birth, I go on to the life of the plant and how is this life charted. How this life is also in terms lived in contradiction. And then I finally go to death of the plant, which is basically where can it end up. And that is the biography of the cannabis plant. And then I go to the next. So I think I will stop here. And thank you so much for me.
Question. Yeah. Professor Nambiar, can I say one thing? Dr. Nambiar, one little thing.
Yes, sir.
Can you hear me? Can I say just one or two little things?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.